All right, let's take our Bibles and turn to the book of Isaiah and the very famous chapter 53. Isaiah 53. Yeah, I just bit my tongue this morning when he said, oh, by the way, happy Valentine's Day to everybody, because I could care less about Valentine's Day. It's another pagan, satanic holiday based on a false god named Cupid. But, anyway, so, all right, Isaiah chapter 53, I'm just going to preach from a certain passage, a part of this chapter. We'll read much of it, almost the whole chapter, but there's one phrase that's been jumping out at me in the last, couple of days, I guess, and I was going to do a word study on this during the Bible study hour on Sunday morning, but we're going to go ahead and do it tonight because I can't wait. I don't want to wait. I want to preach this message tonight. I believe God wants me to. And so we'll just do the word study along the way. So Isaiah 53, we'll start with verse 1. Who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. And we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. In other words, not his own, but ours. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors. And he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. I decided to go ahead and read the whole chapter since 11 verses is just one verse away from finishing. But anyway, I want to point out to you this morning, what a great chapter, by the way. This is a chapter that foretells. It's a prophecy given well over 700 years before Jesus was ever born in Bethlehem, and foretelling his death and the fact that he would die for us, that he would bear our iniquities. Now I want to point out two verses, and one in particular, and that is verse 6. The Bible says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And then this phrase, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Then I want you to look at verse 11. Verse 11 says, he shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. by his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. That last phrase, he shall bear their iniquities. So I want to talk to you about why the difference. The iniquity of us all, and he shall bear their iniquities. Notice one is singular, and then the other is plural. So I just want to point out something. I think there's something good for us to know from this. And I was going to just preach on verse 6, and then I noticed verse 8 has it in plural form, the word iniquity, but iniquity is plural. And because of what I'd already meditated on, what I was going to preach on in verse 6, verse 11 fits right in, so I'll include that tonight. But let's pray and let's ask for God's blessing. And while you're there, while you sit there, you pray and ask God to help you to understand and get the message that God has for you regarding why he said that the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity singular of us all. Father, I pray that you'd bless the message, and I pray that you'd do a work in our hearts because we understand a difference between a plural form of a word and the singular form of the word. And I pray that you'd speak to our hearts and enrich, strengthen our faith in you and deepen our love for you as our understanding is expanded. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. First thing I want to do is just point out that the Lord laid on him, on Jesus, the iniquity of us all. And that's the amazing thing. He who knew no sin, the Bible says in Hebrews, or 1 Peter, I forget which, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So Jesus is the most wonderful. I want so bad. I was reading this afternoon, and you know how sometimes you start off reading the Bible, you start off in Genesis, and boy, you enjoy that much. You learn more. I learn more every time I read Genesis. Then you get into Exodus, and it's going good because you're reading about the 10 plagues, you know, in Egypt, and how the God miraculously parted the waters and led them across and then drowned Pharaoh's army. And boy, it's going good. You read about them camping. You're reading about them wanting water. Then you read about them wanting meat and, you know, and complaining. And you read all these stories. And all of a sudden, you get to a certain chapter, and it starts talking about stuff that you get lost. And then you lose your enthusiasm. Pretty soon, you're way off your Bible reading schedule. All right? So, I mean, you've been there. You understand what I'm talking about. Okay. All right, well, I was reading a chapter today about the sacrifices that God commanded Moses and Aaron and his sons to do. And I almost decided to preach on that tonight, but I won't, so I'll give you a heads up. I'm going to soon. I'm going to break down some amazing things. There's nothing, there is nothing boring in the Bible anywhere. I used to have a saying from my workers, you know, I put it up in the closet, or I was over the cleaning of the buildings, and a lot of times people work, you know, it's such a drudgery, you know, mopping, swinging that mop. I came up with a saying. I don't know if I heard it somewhere and it stuck in my subconscious, I don't know, I always figured I thought of it myself, but I doubt that because I know the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun, so I'm not claiming any responsibility for it. But it just came to me one day, and I've lived by this statement. Drudgery is a result of a dull mind. There's nothing in life that is a drudgery, or that should be a drudgery. Not for a child of God. Paul and Silas, when they're sitting in prison, hands and feet in the stocks, haven't been whooped, there's no drudgery there. It's quite excitement. Wow, we got beat, man. How you doing? You doing okay? I mean, their emotions were up. Their blood was pumping and flowing out. And that wasn't drudgery. It was exciting. Now, not the kind of excitement you wanted, not the kind of excitement they wanted. Well, maybe they didn't mind. Actually, truth is, they sang praises and counted it a joy that they were counted worthy to suffer for Jesus' name. There's nothing drudgery about that. I don't think Jeremiah was suffering from drudgery when he was in the prison, in the dungeon. I don't think Paul was. I know Peter wasn't. He wasn't taking advantage of it, sleeping. Then an angel came and woke him up, said, "Hey, get up." And anyway, drudgery is a result of a dull mind. And so one of these days, I'm just giving you a heads up, but it has to do with this. I'm gonna brighten and enlighten some of the passage of the Old Testament that seems so boring to people, you know. And he offered this sacrifice as a heave offering, this one as a wave offering, and a peace offering, a sin offering, transgression offering, and free will offering. And there's all these offerings and all these animals, a bullock and doves, turtle doves, and rams and lambs and a firstling and all this stuff. It's like all this trivia, which is not trivial at all, but all this trivia, all these details just boggles the mind, and it causes people to break down their Bible reading schedule. Now, all of those things, I say all that to say, all those things represent Jesus. And one of these days, I'm going to show you a beautiful picture. Not only does it represent Jesus, but it represents our relationship with Him. And the one I'm going to do one of these days is show you, well, I'll just leave that for another. Anyway, another time when I actually preach it. But anyway, Jesus became our sacrifice. He was the Lamb of God. John the Baptist saw Him and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." Now, so Jesus is our sacrifice. And so this Bible, this chapter is telling us, verse 4, "Surely He hath borne our griefs." And here's another amazing thing about Jesus I want to tell you. Remember, the Bible says that Jesus was the Lamb slain from the foundations of the world? Well, look at verse 4 says, "Surely He hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows." Now, what tense is that? Yeah, that's past tense. Recorded 700 years before Jesus was born in Bethlehem. Surely He hath borne our griefs? Is it sure that He has done that? Yeah, because He's the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. With God, there's no need for time, because when God says He's going to do something, it's as good as done. And God inhabits eternity. He's in every part of eternity. He's in the past, present, future at all times, you might say. I don't know. I'm not sure I understand it fully. I'm not going to try to. I'm not going to claim that I understand it, but I believe that He was wounded. Look at verse 5. You see it again. He was wounded for our transgressions. Didn't say He's going to be wounded for our transgressions. No, in the mind of God, it's already occurred. See? So, by the way, the good news about that is there's never a point in your life where you have to worry about, "Oh, I need to get forgiveness for sins I haven't done yet or that I just did recently, because I know Jesus saved me from my sins way back when I asked Him to, but what about all the ones since?" Well, all your sins, even the ones you haven't even committed yet, He already bore before He went to the cross. Because, you know, physically in history, it's already done as far as God's concerned. Now, by the way, I could show you also in other places in the Bible, there's a place where the Bible says, referring to Jesus, "I gave my back to the smiters." That also was written long before Jesus was born and long before He was beaten on the back. Now, so Jesus is our sacrifice. But I want to focus, because I don't want to be too long tonight. I want to focus on that phrase, "And the Lord hath laid on Him the iniquity of us all." That word "laid," it's kind of like if someone's carrying a big old burden. They've got a big old load. And they're struggling under that load. And all of a sudden they find a place where they can rest it and lay their burden down, and they let it down and have such relief. God has laid on Him, on Jesus, the iniquity of us all. Now who gets the relief? Well, Certainly, who's carrying it? The Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. What's laying him down? What's the burden? What's the weight? The iniquity. Well, whose iniquity? The iniquity of us all. So who's bearing the burden? Before Jesus does. Before it's laid on him. We are. We are. That's why Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. We're laden about. The Bible talks about widows, young widows can be laden with sins and so forth. And because they're young and not mature enough to handle single motherhood or widowhood or whatever. And so Paul says, let them marry. Get them, if they're young, let them marry again. But anyway, so God, the iniquity of us, is we're the ones that have the burden to bear. We're the ones that have guilt to bear. We're the ones that carry guilt and shame for our sin. Some folks don't carry much guilt. They have a lot of guilt. They should. They've got a big old burden, but don't know it because they're not being responsible and they're not recognizing it. It's like some folks have debts, but they live as if they have no debts. They live on credit and they're borrowing and they're living oblivious of a big elephant in the room, so to speak. Now, so the truth is, all of us, our sins. Are a burden to us. But I want you to see something. I just emphasize the word laid there for just that moment there, or that last couple minutes. But I want you to notice, the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. It's singular. It's singular. The Lord took from us all of our sins and laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all. Now, I'm going to break down a word for you. And yes, I did check this out, so I'm not doing it off the top of my head. The word iniquity. I may not say this, but I know it's true because I looked it up. And they won't necessarily say it means this, but it does. Because then you'll see it broken down in other places. But anyway, word iniquity has a prefix in, which means not or no. And then... What's left? Well, I-Q-U-I-T-Y, iquity. Well, what's iquity? Well, you just change that I to a E, equity. Now, what is equity? Equity is basically, it comes from the root word of equal, means equal. Now, so here's the thing. Here's what iniquity is. When God laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all, God looks at us in one way. And that is, he created us in our image and we're not behaving like people in his image. There is an inequity. Hey, I made you in my image, but you're not reflecting my image. That's an iniquity. That's an inequity. It's not equal. I created you to be this way, and you're this way. That's not right. And it doesn't matter what your iniquities, plural, are. God sees it one way. It's an inequity. I don't care if you lie, steal, cheat, murder, rape, or promiscuous in some other way. Or you abuse other people, you abuse your own body. It doesn't matter what kind of sin you have. If you don't reflect what God made you, the image he made you after, it's unequal. That's why it doesn't matter how many sins you commit. You don't go to hell because of the number of sins you commit. You go to hell for one reason. Nobody goes to hell for drinking alcohol. Now, they'll suffer for drinking alcohol in hell. They'll suffer for their sins, but that's not why they go. The difference between iniquity and iniquities is the same difference between what you suffer and why you suffer. Why someone suffers if they go to hell and what they suffer. You suffer based on your sins. But the fact that you even have to go there is based on one sin. The inequity, the not equalness. Now, what's it got to do with whether we go to heaven or hell? Now, before I'll get to that in a little bit, but let me just finish, make a couple more statements more about this. God is no respecter of persons. He's no respecter of sins. God is not going to look at one person's sin as being worse than your sin. That's why I like this statement. That it's a pretty good statement, though. You don't find it in the Bible, but I think the principle's there. At least the way we understand, the ground is level at the foot of the cross. The Bible talks about, as Christians, there's no difference. Romans 3, there's no difference. Neither Jew nor Greek nor Gentile nor barbarian nor Scythian nor bond nor free. It doesn't matter what you are. The Lord hath laid on Jesus the iniquity, the inequity, the unequalness, the iniquity of us all. Doesn't matter how many iniquities you have or how few compared to somebody. It's the iniquity that God's concerned about. You see, it's the fact that we don't match up with what God intended when He made us. See, and by the way, the reason I'm emphasizing this a little bit tonight is because here's what destroys churches. Here's what causes church splits. As people, you get Pharisaical, and they look down at somebody because of their sin, and they don't look at their own. That's exactly what Jesus is talking about. Hey, don't worry about the speck in someone else's eye. Take care of the mote in their eye. Take care of the beam in your eye. They're both iniquity. You see? So, We've got to realize this, and that's why I want to preach this message, because churches have splits, churches have problems, people have problems in their relationships, couples have problems in relationships, the wife thinks the husband's sin is worse than hers, the husband thinks the wife's sin is worse than his, and a brother thinks his little brother, his punk brother's sin and misbehavior is worse than his, and on it goes. But the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity, singular, of us all. We're all unequal. None of us are what God intended us to be. Okay? Now, do you think you got that? Okay? It's the iniquity of us all that the Lord laid on him. Now, there's details. That's just the general thing. The inequity or the iniquity or an unequalness that none of us are what we ought to be. And so, therefore, if we don't trust in Christ as our Savior, and we don't take advantage of that eternal life that God offers us, and we die and go to hell, then we have to bear our own iniquities, plural. And we'll suffer. There's different degrees of torment and suffering in hell. David says, though, if I make my bed in the lowest hell or though I make my bed in hell, I guess, but there's places to talk about the lowest hell, see? And generally, most people believe that means there are different degrees of suffering based on, and that kind of makes sense. You know, I mean, everybody ought to go to hell who's never done the one thing that God required you to do to not go to hell. But if you end up going to hell, you ought to pay for all the things that you did. And some folks do sin more than other people do. Some do, in our regard, in the way we look at it, the way we measure sin and categorize them, some sins are worse. I think murder is worse than hating somebody. But God calls it the same thing. Because He looks at it's the same because it's unequal. This is unequal, that's unequal, this is unequal, that's unequal, that's not like me, this not like me, that's not like me. It doesn't matter what degree you're not like Christ, the iniquity is that you're not like Him. But yet if you have to suffer for your sin because you don't trust Christ your Savior, all the individuality and the degree of it, you have to suffer. So now, that also tells us this. Not only did God lay on Jesus the iniquity, the unequalness of us all, but He bore our iniquities. See, when Jesus suffered hell for us, He didn't just go there, dip His soul in there for 1 second and then come out. Yeah, He could have, but that's not all He did. While He was there, He bore the degree
of our iniquities, plural. Jesus went to hell and he became, that's why the Bible says he was numbered with the transgressors. And that's why the Bible says in Isaiah 53, we read where he was smitten of God. We did esteem him smitten of God. You know, people thought, oh boy, he's getting God's judgment because he claimed to be God. He was God. But he was smitten of God for a different reason than the Pharisees thought he was being smitten of God for. He was smitten of God. See? And that's why the Bible says, and not only was he smitten physically on the cross, but look at verse 11. Well, okay, verse 10. Two things. We see the first and second death that Jesus suffered for us. Pictured here. Verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. That's physical. When you get a bruise, that's in your flesh, right? So I was talking about the physical suffering. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. It pleased the Lord for Jesus to be whipped and have nails driven through his hands and his feet and a crown of thorns on his head. It pleased the Lord for Jesus to suffer physically. Because the physical death is the first death. The wage of sin is death. It includes both the first death and the second death. But look at verse 11. He shall see the first 10 is the body. Verse 11, he shall see of the travail of his soul. Of his soul? What's the travail of Jesus' soul? Look, they nailed him to the cross. He never cried out. They whipped him in the judgment hall. He never cried out. They planted that crown of thorns on his head. He never cried out. But at some point, when the sun went dark, there's a voice that cried out and said, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" I think Jesus suffered. His soul was in travail. I think Jesus has the ability to be in more places than once. I mean, he said in John chapter 3, no man hath ascended in heaven except he that hath descended. Except the Son of Man, which is in heaven, he said. He's standing on earth saying he's in heaven. And I think while he's on the cross, the Bible says, yes, you'll see the travail of his soul. I think he dipped his soul into hell. We know he went to the heart of the earth. The Bible says that too. But not just the body, but the soul. He shall see the travail of his soul. That's why Psalm 16 talks about Jesus. It's a conversation between God the Father and God the Son where he says, "My flesh shall rest in hope, for thou wilt not leave my soul in hell." What's the travail of Jesus' soul when he suffers the second death? When he suffers hell for us, you see. And that's where you find he shall bear their iniquities, plural. Jesus suffered when he dipped his soul into hell. His soul was in travail because all of a sudden, he who is holy became unholy. He who is truth became a liar. He who is a giver of life became a shedder of blood and a murderer. He was judged for all of our iniquities. And he suffered what we would suffer for eternity. And only an infinite God can do that. We can't. It's hard to comprehend. It's mathematical to me. If you have an equal sign and the penalty for sin, if you sin against an infinite God, you pay an infinite penalty. And therefore, the only person who could pay an infinite penalty would be an infinite being. And we're not that, but God is. And so Jesus stepped in and he balanced the account. And so when Jesus stepped in our place and bore our iniquities in his body, bore our sins in his body, on the tree. That's why I think he dipped his soul in hell while he's on the tree. He bore our sins in his body on the tree. Because I think while on the tree, he's in two places at once. I think he dipped his soul into hell. But anyway, so now Jesus, having paid, since an infinite God has stepped in our place and paid the infinity, the infinitesimal punishment for our sin. He balanced the account. Except there's one more thing to the equation. That equation needs to be applied to certain people. And it's only applied to people who believe. in him. God offers. He has this question. Hey, I'll balance your account. You've got sins and they're recorded in heaven. If you'll put your faith and trust in me and believe in me, then I will count your faith as righteousness. And I'll count what Jesus did and I'll apply his account to your account. You've got a deficit. He's got an infinite surplus. In fact, you've got an infinite deficit. And he's got an infinite surplus. I'll apply his surplus to your deficit and balance your account. But only if you put faith in me. And so I love this. I love how God's plan is an amazing plan. So Jesus bore in his body our sins on the tree. He shall bear their iniquities. Jesus suffered it all. Now, how does this work out? Okay, now, if I have a debt that is an infinite debt I cannot pay, then I have a problem. But Jesus is the solution for that problem. If I put my faith in him, then he comes, and if you have scales, you know, and you put down the heavy weight of our sin, and which is an infinite penalty, which means the scales, it wouldn't have a bottom, okay? But Jesus can step on the other side and add his infinitesimal suffering and the travail of his soul. And he dipped his soul in hell, and he balances that account. And that balance is applied to us when we put our faith and trust in Christ. See? So, that's why the Bible says in Romans so many places that amongst each other as believers, we're not supposed to look at each other at what sins we commit and judge each other by what kind of sins. They're all under the blood. They're all under the blood. People are so made. See, the world's not that way. The world says, oh, so-and-so, he's a thief. Well, or like I was showing somebody, I got stacks this thick of notifications, because we're a church, and churches tend to have children, of notifications of sex offenders living in the area. Oh, I file them away, I don't know. I don't know anybody say I don't do anything with them, but I don't do anything with them. They just go in a file. I look at them, and I look at, oh, man, Lord, please save that soul. I pray for them. Amen. Jesus died for all those sins. Amen. So many people just were laden with iniquities. See? And mostly we're laden with iniquity as God sees it. It's unequalness. We're not like what he intended. It doesn't matter what degree you're not like God. You're not. You know, it's like, okay. Do you think the government cares if they find a counterfeit dollar bill? Oh, yeah, this counterfeit's worse than that other counterfeit. Well, let's send him to prison longer. Oh, you did a pretty good counterfeit. Okay, you only get 6 days in jail. No, if it's counterfeit, it's counterfeit. Doesn't matter how bad the degree of the counterfeit is, it's counterfeit. And if we're not like Christ, when God intended us to be like him, he made us in his image, if we're not like him, it doesn't matter how much we're not like him, it doesn't matter what degree and what aspect we're not like him, we're not like him. It's iniquity. And so we in the church need to realize that that's why I don't look at, do you mind if I tell you where you came from?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. We got a first-time visitor today came. He said he came straight out of jail, prison, something. Oh, jail? I heard that. It's like water off a duck's back to me. That doesn't bother me one whit. I've had people walk in here, had a couple come back years ago, and they said to me, the man came to me and says, Pastor, well, no, we really like the Bible study. They came on a Wednesday night. They came, and he said, we really like that Bible study, and we like to come to church, but I got to tell you, I have to register as a sex offender, and I don't know if I'd be welcome in this church. And I said, well, you don't know me very well. Of course you're welcome. We may watch you with one eye open all the time, in case there's kids around, but that's only for the sake of the kids. But not, we don't, I will not, I told him, I said, I will not think of you in that regard at all. Except just a little part, if there's ever kids around, I'm not going to trust human nature. I won't trust your human nature, but I'll offer you all kinds of trust to grow in the Lord and be what God wants. You know, I've seen God change people's lives. I believe in the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. I believe in the power of forgiveness. I don't believe in holding people under a label that the world's put on them, or that even they put on themselves, because Jesus is able to wipe all those labels away and call us righteous. He said there's none righteous, no, not one. Yet that's what he calls us, right? Are we called righteous? You know, Psalm 1, right? The Lord knoweth the way of the ungodly, or the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. There's a difference between ungodly and righteous. Righteous, now by the way, the word righteous means to be full of right. I tell that all the time. I told somebody that yesterday when I was soul winning yesterday. It means to be full of. O-U-S is the ending, means to be full of. Like courageous, full of courage. Gracious, full of gracious. Righteous means to be full of right. Be full of right. And if you sin, you can't be full of right because you had room for sin. So there's none righteous. We've all sinned. But when we put our faith and trust in Christ as our Savior, since there's nothing we can do to pay for our sin, we can't go to hell long enough to pay for the damage we've done to the Lord in being for our iniquity, not being like He intended. We can't, the hurt that we've caused Him, we can never pay for. But Jesus can. And if our faith is in Christ, and God sees that faith, He counts that faith as being full of right, because there's nothing wrong. There's no room for sin. And you can't, there's no part of believing in Christ that's sinful. It's all righteous. It's righteousness. And God, that's why God counts your faith as righteousness. And therefore, you balance out. There's no, well, you need to do some more righteous things. No, you can't do righteousness. That's why we're not saved by the righteousness of the law. Because if there's righteousness of the law that you could do, that means there's some that you haven't done yet, so there's no fullness, see. But one act, one thing, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and your faith will be counted as righteousness. And therefore, that takes away all labels. You're no longer a sinner. You're no longer the list in Revelation 21:8, unbelieving. I tell this to people, and I'm soul winning sometimes if I go in this detail. Do you believe everything in the Bible? And while they think about it, I said, then I give them a clue. You don't even know everything in there, so you can't. You've never made a judgment about everything in the Bible because you never even read it all, have you? So therefore, there's something you might not believe if you knew what it said. And do you always act on what you know the Bible says? No, okay. Well, that believing is doing, acting. By faith, Abraham did something. By faith, Abel did something. By faith, Jacob did something. Your actions show what you believe. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So there's things that people see that are evidence of what they can't see. If I believe something, if I believe I can hold this thing up over my head with just a finger and a thumb, believing it doesn't do me any good until I do it. Yeah. I get the balance here. Anyway, it's changing on me. Can't find the balance that's moving, but anyway. But I can. One finger, one thumb. Now, I believed I could, but what good is that belief if I don't do it? Now, we're not saved by works. We're saved by faith. God sees our faith. See, when it comes to salvation, now, are we supposed to work for the Lord? Service is all about works. It's all about faith and works. Show me your faith by your works. That's talking about serving God. It's not talking about salvation. Salvation is our faith in the work that Jesus did. The finished work of Calvary. It's not our work. We're not saved by our works. See? Now, so the iniquity
becomes the unequalness becomes equal when we put our faith in Christ, and the infinitesimal suffering of Christ is applied to our account. And now that debt we owe is paid. It's reckoned as paid by Christ on our behalf because we trusted him. And it's accredited to our account. Now, there's an escrow payment for everybody in the world. Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. It's kind of like an escrow, you might say. It's available to be applied. It's only applied to the accounts of those who put their faith in Christ. And God counts their faith as righteousness. Now, just like Abraham believed God, and it, his belief, his faith, was counted as righteousness. And so Abraham's sins were wiped away. Now, so that means now, as a child of God, there is no iniquity. Sin and iniquity are the same thing. Iniquity is just a different way to say sin that illustrates the lack of unevenness. Okay? Is there sin with God? Yes or no?
No.
Is there sin with us? Yes. So we're not equal. It's the same thing. It's just a different, it's like a synonym. Like glasses, spectacles. Same thing. There's no difference. All right? Now, what's that?
Potato, potato.
Yeah, potato, potato, yeah. Cantaloupe with an E, cantaloupe without an E. Doesn't matter. Anyway, so the Jesus takes care of the balance. So, lost my place where I was going to go now, but let me show you something. Look at verse 11 again. Look what happens. When God sees the travail of his soul, he shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. Satisfied. See. Now, we did a word study on satisfied. I hope I can remember off the top of my head. But I believe the root word of satisfy is fica, ficare, from the Latin, which means to make. So we get like manufacture. It means to make with your hands. Mono to mono. Let's fight man to man. Hand to hand. Okay? So manufacture. Okay? So satisfaction. Satis, I think, is, if I can remember, it means to be full. See? So satisfaction means to make full. All right? Now, there's an emptiness that God feels because he made us in his image and we're not. He's not satisfied. It's kind of like the opposite. David said in Psalm 17:15, I think it is, he says, I shall be satisfied when I awake in his likeness. I'll be made full. That's all my longings will come to pass. The whole creation groaneth, travaileth, waiting for the adoption, to it the redemption of our body. That's when we have real satisfaction. We become all that God intended for us to be. But as sinners, there's no satisfaction with God the way we are. But when God saw the travail of Jesus' soul, he's satisfied because he knows now he can be made full. And whole in the sense, made full. His joy can be made full because the payment's made. And now people, as long as they'll choose to trust him, can be saved. And they'll be like him. We'll be like him when we shall see him as he is. And he'll be made full. That's exactly what I had in mind when I created you. That's why the Bible says that Jesus, in Jude chapter, well, there's only one chapter, but anyway, Jude 24 and 25, it talks about Jesus says that he will present us there with, before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Why? He'll be satisfied. He's satisfied. He made full God's demand for the payment of sin. There's no, you're in heaven now. You got to work for me the rest of all eternity to make up for all your sins. No. There's going to be no obligation to serve God for all eternity. No obligation. We'll be like him. We'll want to. We won't want anything else.
All our desires will be perfected. You talk about joy and bliss. Wow. We're having multiple word studies tonight. I love that word, satisfy. To make full. That is an awesome word. And that comes only as a result of God being satisfied when he sees the travail of his soul. When Jesus, who bore our iniquities, when the iniquity, singular, of us all, the unequalness of us all was laid on him. Wow. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, hallelujah! His heart was broken on Calvary. His hands were nail-scarred. His side was riven. I love that song. I want to sing it. I'd butcher it. I love that song. Oh, what a Savior. What a wonderful Savior we have. He satisfies. The only thing that satisfies God. Wow. Yeah. Sometimes time like this, and I preach on this subject, I feel like I'm totally incapable of doing it justice. What a Savior we have. So, now because the iniquity of us all was laid on him, it is possible for us to be free of iniquity, free from sin. Now, not in his flesh, but God has made another way. And this is the last thing I'll show you. I think. First John chapter 3. Turn to 1 John chapter 3. This goes so well, this is kind of like the cherry on top. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 7. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Now, verse 9, key verse. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. Wow, do you see that? Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. I remember struggling that as a young man, thinking, I know I'm saved, but Lord, I just sinned. I just got mad at my brother for no cause. I was just jealous, or I was just envious, or I was just being selfish, and he got a bigger piece of pie than I did, and I shouldn't complain about that. Lord, I know I sinned. Please forgive me, but Lord, aren't I saved? Aren't I saved? I just committed sin. I used to struggle with this. Whether I was saved or not, it caused doubts about my salvation. Till one day I was meditating on this verse, and it dawned on me. When someone asked me, who are your parents? And I said, in a formal way, I was born of my father and of my mother. And then it hit me. This verse popped in my head. My body was born of my father and my mother. But God knew me before he formed me in the belly, like he said about Jeremiah. But there's something else that God knows. See, we're born with a dead spirit we inherited. God just foreknew me before I was born. He didn't know me spiritually. I hadn't been born again. I didn't have a spirit. My spirit was dead. But the day I trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior, the day that I met Jesus and realized who he was and trusted him, I got born into God's family. My dead spirit was quickened by faith in the living Word of God. The Word of God which lives and abides forever. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the Word of God which liveth and abideth forever. And so I was born of the Word of God. Jesus is the Word. Jesus and God are the same. Jesus, the Holy Spirit, they're the same. I was born of the Word, born of the Spirit, and I got born again that day. A new creature. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. It's not a refabrication of the old. No, I still got the old. I still have the same tastes. Still have some of the same desires physically that I had I still have today, after being saved, some of the same desires that I had before I got saved. See, there's a distinct difference between that which is born of the flesh and that which is born of the Spirit. John 3, 5, and 6. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto you, ye must be born again. And if you're born again, what's born then is born of the Spirit. And whatsoever is of God has God's attributes. Is God holy? Yes, he's holy. So when you get born of God, your spirit is holy. And that's what's born of God. So, all of a sudden, verse 9 makes a lot of sense. Whosoever, the spirit that's born of God, whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. It's your old nature that commits sin, it's not your spirit. See, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God. In this new birth, in this the children of God, not children of parents, children of men, but the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. See, now I remember as a child having some sibling rivalries. Times I didn't love my brothers. But who didn't love my brother? It was the old me. The new me loves my brothers very deeply. So deeply, sometimes I feel like Joseph. Sometimes I wish, our family's not expressive, I wish sometimes I could grab all my brothers and my sisters, and I wish I had big enough, long enough arms to just hug them all and just bring them all and squeeze them so tight, they all come in my heart. We just become one. That's the kind of love I have for my brothers and my sister, my family. And by the way, for you too, everybody in the church, that's the way I feel. I feel bound to you as if we're one. But that's only in the spirit. But in the flesh, sometimes, ew, your breath stinks. Or ew, this, or ew, that. And see, and this is why we need to learn to recognize the fact that the Lord hath laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. And we need to look at each other with new eyes. As children of God, let's look at each other as people whose iniquity, whose unequalness has been laid on Jesus, and therefore we shouldn't worry about it. But sometimes in the flesh we have to deal with it. You know, here's a guy who was a thief. Then he gets saved. He's just breaking into houses and steals people's stuff and traumatize them. And whether they're home or if they come home and find out their private property has been violated, it's traumatic to the soul. And they've been doing that to people. But then they get saved. Well, praise the Lord. Hey, glad to have you in the family. And hope to see you next Sunday. But then they sit next to you and you make sure your wallet's in your pocket and pull your purse close to you, you know. Now, can you love them? Yeah, in Christ. But don't forget, he's dragging around with him an old flesh everywhere he goes. See, and you never know when he's gonna step in that old fleshly body and say, well, I think I want to walk in the flesh a while. But then he hears the word of God and he humbles himself. Oh, Lord, I don't want to live that way. And he stops walking in the flesh and walks in the spirit for a while. That's just a crude illustration. But what I'm trying to say is we need to recognize the differences between iniquity and iniquities. Iniquities is what the flesh does. Iniquity is a general state that we're not equal with God. But that as children born of God, we're made manifest by the fact we've been born again. So I can look at someone like Brother Unger, or Brother Guy, Brother Scott, Brother Morrison. I can look at the various men in the church. Ladies, I look at you different. No, just kidding. I set that one up, didn't I? Now, I can look at all of you and look at you like God
sees our record in heaven. And that's what all of us should do to each other. Give everybody the opportunity to have a place where they can come and feel like they're loved and no one's judging them as being anything that you've been in the past. But now we have to recognize you have a flesh, but we're going to give you that trust. You'll have to lose that trust by your actions. See? Now, what happens if someone does? What if someone violates our trust? Well, we have an opportunity to be like God again and offer them forgiveness. That's what Matthew 18 is about. A brother comes to you, or Peter says, Lord, if my brother sinned against me, do I forgive him 7 times? And Jesus said, 70 times 7. Doesn't mean that's the limit, 490, okay? He just emphasized, forgive completely. But the principle from Matthew 18 is, let him come to you and acknowledge his sin. Just like we don't get forgiveness for God unless we acknowledge that we're sinners and we need a Savior. The average Joe Blow running around and doing what he wants, he doesn't have forgiveness from God. It's available, but he doesn't have it. It's not applied to him until he, by faith, receives Christ, who steps in the balances and balances it out. His faith is counted as righteousness. Same thing with a brother. A brother who has faith in God's word to admit that, yes, what I did is wrong, deserves your forgiveness every time he or she admits it. And you say, but I'm getting so tired of that. Whoa. You getting tired of forgiving your brother? You're tired of forgiving your sister? What about God? Don't you think he gets tired of forgiving you for your sins? No, he doesn't. He gets tired of putting up with people claiming they're forgiven when they've really not put their faith in him. Jesus, the Bible talks about where God says, I am weary of your solemn assemblies. I am weary of your incense. I'm wearied of your sacrifices. I'm tired of it all because you're offering it as an outward motion, but there's no heart. Your heart is far from me. You honor me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. God gets weary of people's sacrifices who don't mean it. God gets weary of people who play church, but they've never been saved. God never wearies when those whom he knows are their frame as dust. He neither slumbers nor sleeps. He doesn't get weary. See, he's long-suffering. Praise the Lord. What a wonderful Savior we have. So, I hope every time you think of that phrase, the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all, I hope it changes and deepens your understanding of it. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you bless the message. Lord, help us to be more like you. Help us to learn to look at each other differently and see each other as you see us. And yes, we have to negotiate in a sense. We've got to handle both the flesh and the spirit, the presence of both in each other. God, give us the wisdom to recognize the difference. Learn how to handle both in our own lives and the lives of our brothers and sisters. Give us that grace. Help us to grow in grace. You made your grace available to us. Help us to always have grace for others. And I pray that you bless us. And may this church provide exactly that's what, your plan, and that is an environment where people can come and find grace in your sight and find grace in the sight of others who will see them differently. Won't label them, but have enough understanding to know how to handle when someone walks in the flesh. Lord, give us wisdom. Give us understanding and give us that love of the brethren that you said would show the world that we are your disciples. Bless the message to our heart, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.